Recorded Books and RB Digital present Mayo Clinic, Guide to Your Baby's First Years. Second edition, written by Dr. Walter J. Cook, MD, and Dr. Kelsey M. Klaas, MD. Narrated by Lori Gardner. Part 1, Caring for Your Child. Chapter 1, Welcome to Parenthood. Congratulations, you are now entering one of the greatest phases of your life, parenthood. There is perhaps nothing in life more special than the bond that forms between a parent and a child. It's a relationship that will bring endless years of joy, laughter, admiration, and satisfaction. The time you spend raising your child will be time that you will cherish forever. In the years to come, you'll learn more about attachment, love, and protectiveness than you ever thought possible. But be prepared that not every day in your parenthood journey will be grand and glorious. Like everything else in life, there will be ups and downs. You may find that some of the more stressful and exhausting days of being a parent will come early on, when you first bring your new son or daughter home. Bringing a baby into your house can literally turn your life upside down. The routine you once knew, having time to yourself, getting together with friends, going out for a relaxing dinner, or spending the day indulging in your favorite hobby, has been put on hold. In its place is a reality that may feel totally foreign to you. That's because children don't arrive with instruction manuals, and parenting is somewhat of a trial by fire experience. If you've never had to care for a young child before, you may feel nervous, unsure of yourself, and a bit lost. That's to be expected, and is perfectly normal. Parenting 101. Many parents describe their first year with a new baby as a roller coaster ride. As one new mom put it, one minute you're laughing and joking, the next minute you're crying, not really knowing why. You may go from adoring your baby and marveling at tiny fingers and toes to grieving your loss of independence and worrying about your ability to care for a newborn, all in the space of a single diaper change. Given all these changes, the first few weeks after you bring your baby home are likely to be one of the most challenging times of your life. The changes in the daily rhythms of your life can feel chaotic, but you will learn to adapt. It may take months or even more, but you'll get there in your own way, in your own time, and with your own missteps and triumphs. Relish the time. As chaotic as it may seem, this is a special time in your life. Appreciate the joy your son or daughter brings to your life, and don't let your worries overshadow your joys. Baby days won't last long. Step back and appreciate the moment. For all the strain associated with these first years, parenthood brings an incredible richness to daily living. Nothing can quite compare to the joy of meeting a newborn's gaze or accompanying the wobbly first steps of a toddler. Trust your instincts. Caring for a child may be totally new territory for you, but have confidence in yourself. You'll quickly learn the things you need to know to take great care of your child. Also, realize that you aren't expected to know it all. It's okay to ask questions and seek guidance from friends, family, and medical professionals. If you get unsolicited advice, take the advice that fits with your parenting style and feel free to forget the rest. Check your expectations. Many new parents start out with unrealistic expectations that life won't be much different from before, that parenting is going to be fun every minute of the day, that the new baby will mostly eat and sleep, that they'll be able to manage everything perfectly. The gap between expectations and reality can lead to stress and disappointment. Throw out any preconceived notions about what life with a little one should be like, and be realistic about the increased demands on your time. That cute little 8-pound addition to your household can create a lot of extra work. Be patient. For the first few weeks, your life may seem limited to round-the-clock feeding, bathing, diapering, and soothing. all on shortened amounts of sleep. You may find it difficult to fit in a shower and do a load of laundry, let alone make dinner. You may fear this is what your life is going to be like forever. It won't be. Soon, your baby will be a toddler, and increased mobility, conversation, and independence will bring new adventures. Over time, you'll adjust to each new normal, revive old routines, and create new ones. As your child grows older, you'll find you have a little more time for yourself. Take care of yourself. Childhood care also extends to parents. Taking good care of your child includes taking good care of yourself. The better you feel, the better able you'll be to care for and enjoy your son or daughter. Get as much rest as you can. Eat well and fit in some exercise. Most of all, don't be afraid to ask for help when you need it. Cherish relationships. Children, while wonderful, can be hard on other relationships in your life. If you're starting the parenting journey with your spouse or partner, you may miss your life as just a couple. You may also find that you have differences of opinion on issues related to caring for your child. Be patient with yourself and your partner. Take time to admire his or her relationship with your child, and you will likely find great inspiration, not only as a parent, but also as a couple. This book. As you maneuver the ins and outs of parenting, a little guidance and reassurance can be of great help. Mayo Clinic Guide to Your Baby's First Years is designed to help you find answers to common questions during the first 3 years of a child's life. The book is also intended to provide you with reassurance that you're doing well and that the emotions and concerns you may be experiencing are the same as those of many other parents. Dig in by whatever manner works best for you. You can turn the page and begin reading, or you can selectively choose those chapters or sections that are most important to you right now. Keep the book handy so that you can turn to it whenever a concern arises, or prepare yourself for the months and years ahead. Remember that parenting is an adventure. Enjoy the journey. Chapter 2, Baby's First Days. From the moment you first learned you would have a child, you've been eagerly anticipating the day you could hold your baby and look into his or her face. And now, that day is here. Labor and delivery, or perhaps a lengthy adoption process, is behind you. Now you can finally get to enjoy that precious little person you've been waiting so long to meet. Sometimes the mental picture you've had of your first moments with your baby doesn't exactly match up with reality. Truth is, newly born babies tend to look a bit messy when they emerge, and you may be exhausted and overwhelmed by the birthing process. Don't worry. Give yourself a moment to take it all in. In this chapter, you'll learn what to expect during your newborn's first few weeks of life at home, from bonding opportunities to what newborns typically look like. You'll also learn about standard examinations, procedures, and screenings, and about some of the common conditions seen in newborns. Baby bonding. As soon as a baby is born, he or she is ready to be held, cuddled, stroked, kissed, and talked to. These everyday expressions of love and affection promote bonding to the parent. They also help a baby's brain develop. Just as an infant's body needs food to grow, his or her brain benefits from positive emotional, physical, and intellectual experiences. Relationships with other people early in life have a vital influence on a child's development. Some parents feel an immediate connection with their newborn, while for others, the bond takes longer to develop. Don't worry or feel guilty if you aren't overcome with a rush of love at the very beginning. Not every parent bonds instantly with a new baby. Your feelings will become stronger with time. Bonding moments. During those first few weeks, most of your time with your new son or daughter is likely to be spent feeding him or her, changing diapers, and helping him or her sleep. These routine tasks present an opportunity to bond. When babies receive warm, responsive care, they're more likely to feel safe and secure. For example, as you feed your baby and change diapers, gaze lovingly into his or her eyes and talk gently to him or her. Babies also have times when they're quietly alert and ready to engage and learn. These times may last only a few moments, but you'll learn to recognize them. Take advantage of your baby's alert times to get acquainted and play. Cuddle and touch your baby. Newborns are sensitive to changes in pressure and temperature. They love to be held, rocked, caressed, cradled, snuggled, kissed, patted, stroked, massaged, and carried. Don't worry about spoiling your newborn. Respond to your child's cues and clues warmly and promptly. Among the signals babies send are the sounds they make, the way they move, their facial expressions, and the way they make or avoid eye contact. Pay close attention to your baby's need for activity as well as quiet times. Let your baby watch your face. Soon after birth, your newborn will become accustomed to seeing you and will begin to focus on your face. Allow your baby to study your features and provide plenty of smiles. Play music and dance. To add variety to your baby's day, put on some soft music with a beat. Hold your baby's face close to yours and gently sway and move to the tune. Establish routines and rituals. The first few weeks with your newborn aren't always predictable, but as much as you can. Establish small routines and rituals that help you and your baby get to know each other. For example, spend a few minutes cuddling or rocking after a feeding, or look out a window together when you get up in the morning. Repeated positive experiences provide children with a sense of security. Be patient with yourself in these first weeks. Caring for a new child can be daunting, discouraging, thrilling, and perplexing, all in the same hour. In time, your skills as a parent will grow, and you will come to love this little one far more than you could have imagined. Serve and return. Everyday face-to-face interactions, what some experts call serve and return moments, such as when your baby looks at you and you gaze back, are the best way to stimulate and build the nerve connections and pathways in your baby's brain. Evidence suggests that these early connections help a child grow and thrive, even in the midst of stress. Talk, read, and sing to your baby. These early conversations encourage social and emotional development and provide an opportunity for closeness. Baby's looks. Considering what they've been through during childbirth, it's no wonder newborns don't look like those seen on television or on social media. Instead, your newborn may emerge wrinkled and ruddy. If your baby is like most, his or her head may be a bit misshapen and larger than you expected, and the eyelids may be puffy. His or her arms and legs may be curled in, and the hands and feet may be bluish or purplish in color. He or she may be somewhat bloody and likely wet and slippery from amniotic fluid. In addition, most babies will be born with what looks like skin lotion, called vernix. It's most noticeable under your baby's arms, behind the ears, and in the groin. Most of this vernix will be washed off during your baby's first bath. Head. At first, your baby's head may appear flat, elongated, or crooked. This particular elongation is one of the common features of a newly born baby. A baby's skull consists of several sections of bone that are flexibly joined so that the head shape can change to correspond to the shape of your pelvis as your baby moves through the birth canal during childbirth. A long labor usually results in an elongated or tall skull shape at birth. The head of a breech baby may have a shorter, broader appearance. If a vacuum extractor was used to assist in the birth, your baby's head may look particularly elongated. Sometimes you can feel ridges on your baby's head where the sections of bone have overlapped. As your baby's head shape normalizes over the first few days, these ridges will go away, and your baby's head will take on a more rounded appearance. Fontanelles. When you feel the top of your baby's head, you'll notice two soft areas. These soft spots, called fontanelles, are where your baby's skull bones haven't grown together yet. The fontanelle, toward the front of the scalp, is a diamond-shaped spot, roughly the size of a quarter. Though it's usually flat, it may bulge when your baby cries or strains. By the time your child is 2 years old, this fontanelle will be filled in with hard bone. The smaller fontanelle at the back of the head is less noticeable. This fontanelle is about the size of a dime, and it closes much quicker, around 6 weeks after birth. Some parents are anxious about touching baby's soft spots, partly because they don't like the way they feel. Don't worry, you won't hurt your baby if you do touch a fontanelle. A rounded swelling of the scalp is usually seen on the top and back of the baby's head when a baby is born head first. This puffiness disappears within a day or so. Skin. Most babies are born with some bruising, and skin blotches and blemishes are common. Pressure from your pelvis during labor can cause a bruise on your baby's head. The bruise may be noticeable for several weeks, and you might feel a small bump that persists for several months. You may also see scrapes or bruises on your baby's face and head if forceps were used during delivery. These bruises and blemishes generally go away within a couple of weeks. The top layer of a newborn skin flakes off shortly after birth. You may notice plenty of dry, peeling skin the first few weeks. In general, this gets better on its own. In the meantime, apply some petroleum jelly to baby's skin. Evidence suggests that daily moisturizing of a baby's skin during the first 6 months of life can help prevent the development of eczema. Petroleum jelly is generally the most cost-effective, but other emollients such as Aquaphor or creams such as Cetaphil or Fenacream also work. There are other common newborn skin conditions such as Melia and baby acne. Birthmarks. Contrary to their name, birthmarks aren't always present at birth. Some, such as a hemangioma, develop weeks later. And though most are permanent, a few types fade as a child grows. Most birthmarks are harmless, but some may be treated for cosmetic reasons or because of rapid growth or risk of future health problems. Salmon patch. A salmon patch, sometimes called a stork bite, is a reddish or pink patch that's often found just above or below the hairline, at the back of the neck. The medical term is nevus simplex. Salmon patches may also be found on the eyelids, forehead, or upper lip. These marks are caused by collections of tiny blood vessels, capillaries, close to the skin. Salmon patches on the forehead, eyelids, or between the eyes usually fade with time, though they may flare with increased blood flow to the head, such as when crying, straining, or pushing. Salmon patches on the nape of the neck may not fade, but they're often covered by hair. Salmon patches don't require any type of treatment. Dermal melanosis. Dermal melanosis is a typically harmless, large, blue-gray birthmark that's sometimes mistaken for a bruise. It's more common in babies of Asian, African, or Hispanic backgrounds, and typically appears on the lower back. This birthmark usually disappears later in childhood and doesn't require treatment. Café au lait spot. As the name implies, these birthmarks are light brown or coffee-colored. Café au lait birthmarks are very common, and they can occur anywhere on the body. They're usually permanent but don't require treatment. However, if your child has more than 6 café au lait spots, ask his or her medical provider whether further evaluation might be warranted. Hemangioma. Hemangiomas are caused by an overgrowth of blood vessels in the top layers of skin. Usually not present at birth, a hemangioma may begin as a small, pale spot that becomes red in the center. The birthmark enlarges during the baby's first few months and appears as a bright red raised spot. It most often disappears without treatment by school age. Large hemangiomas may cover an entire segment of the face or body. Some fast-growing hemangiomas may require laser treatment or medication. Babies with several hemangiomas or hemangiomas at certain locations may need evaluation for an underlying condition. Congenital nevus. A congenital nevus is a large, dark-colored mole that typically appears on the scalp or trunk of the body. It can range in size from less than half of an inch to more than 5 inches across, covering large areas. Children with a large-sized congenital nevus are at an increased risk of developing skin cancer as adults. If your child has this type of birthmark, talk with your child's medical provider so that he or she can check for skin changes. Port wine stain. A port wine stain is a permanent birthmark that starts out pink but turns darker red or purple as a child grows. Most often, a port wine stain appears on the face and neck, but it can affect other areas. The involved skin may thicken and develop an irregular pebbled surface. The condition can be treated, often with laser therapy. Facial appearance. When you first look at your baby, his or her nose may seem flattened. This is from pressure inside the birth canal. Within a day or two, the nose will take on a more rounded appearance. His or her cheeks may also have marks or bruises if forceps were used during the delivery. This too will improve in a short time. Eyes. It's perfectly normal for your newborn's eyes to be puffy. Some infants have such puffy eyes that they aren't able to open their eyes wide right away. This will improve within a day or two. You may also notice that your baby sometimes looks cross-eyed. This too is normal, and your child will outgrow the condition within several months. Sometimes babies are born with red spots on the whites of their eyes. These spots result from the breakage of tiny blood vessels during birth. The spots are harmless, and they won't interfere with your baby's sight. They generally disappear in a week to two. Like a newborn's hair, his or her eyes give no guarantee of their future color. Although most newborns have dark bluish-brown, blue-black, grayish-blue, or slate-colored eyes, permanent eye color may take 6 months or even longer to establish itself. Hair. Your baby may be born bald, or with a full head of thick hair, or almost anything in between. Don't fall in love with your baby's hair too quickly. The hair color your baby is born with isn't necessarily what he or she will have 6 months down the road. Blonde newborns, for example, may become darker blonde as they get older, or their hair may develop a reddish tinge that isn't apparent at birth. You may be surprised to see that your newborn's head isn't the only place he or she has hair. Downy, fine hair called lanugo, covers a baby's body before birth and may temporarily appear on your newborn's back, shoulders, forehead, and temples. Most of this hair is shed in the uterus before the baby is born, making lanugo especially common in premature babies. It disappears within a few weeks after birth. First examination. From the moment your little one is born, he or she is the focus of everyone in the room. Often, your medical team will ask you about your preferences after delivery. If your baby appears well, he or she may be placed directly on your chest and covered with a blanket. Alternatively, the medical team may wipe your baby clean, suction his or her mouth and nose, and check his or her heart rate. Sometimes, babies need to be brought to a warmer in the delivery room for a more thorough examination right after delivery. All newborns look somewhat bluish-gray for the first several minutes, especially on their lips and tongue. Within 5 to 10 minutes, they become pinker, though baby's hands and feet may still remain bluish, which is normal. Your baby's umbilical cord is clamped with a plastic clamp, and you or your partner may be given the option to cut it. In the next day or two, the medical team will conduct newborn examinations, administer screening tests, and give some vaccines and preventative treatments designed for newborns. APGAR score. One of the first examinations of your baby will be done to determine his or her APGAR score. An APGAR score is basically a quick evaluation of a newborn's health, which is given at 1 minute and 5 minutes after a baby is born. Developed in 1952 by anesthesiologist Virginia APGAR, this brief examination rates newborns on five criteria: color, heart rate, reflexes, muscle tone, and respiration. Each of these criteria is given an individual score of 0, 1, or 2. The scores are totaled for a maximum possible score of 10. Higher scores indicate healthier infants, but don't get too caught up in the numbers. Your medical provider will tell you how your baby is doing. And even those babies with lower scores often turn out to be perfectly healthy. Other checks and measurements. Soon after birth, your newborn's weight, length, and head circumference are measured. Your baby's temperature may be taken, and breathing and heart rate measured. Usually within 12 hours after birth, a physical exam is conducted to detect any problems or abnormalities. Your child's blood sugar, glucose, also may be checked within the first hour or two after birth. Especially if your baby is somewhat larger or smaller for his or her age, or if he or she seems overly sleepy or has trouble getting started eating. A baby whose blood sugar is too low may be more sleepy than what's usual and won't feed well. Assistance may be given to encourage eating and improve the baby's blood sugar. Treatments and vaccinations. The following steps are generally taken shortly after birth to prevent diseases and conditions that may occur in newborns. Eye protection. To prevent the possibility of infections being passed from mothers to babies, all states require that infants' eyes be protected immediately after birth. Gonorrheal eye infections were a leading cause of blindness until early in the 20th century, when treatment of babies' eyes after birth became mandatory. An antibiotic ointment or solution is placed onto the baby's eyes. These preparations are gentle to the eyes and cause no pain. Vitamin K injection. In the United States, vitamin K is routinely given to infants shortly after they're born. Vitamin K is necessary for normal blood coagulation, the body's process for stopping bleeding after a cut or bruise. Newborns have low levels of vitamin K in their first few weeks. An injection of vitamin K can help prevent the rare possibility that a newborn would become so deficient in vitamin K that serious bleeding might develop. This problem is not related to hemophilia. Hepatitis B vaccination. Babies can contract hepatitis B from their mothers during pregnancy and birth. Protection against hepatitis B begins with a vaccine given shortly after birth. Hepatitis B is a viral infection that affects the liver. It can cause illnesses such as cirrhosis and liver failure, or it can result in the development of liver tumors. These conditions are more likely to develop in people who are infected with the virus as a child. Newborn issues. Some babies have a bit of trouble adjusting to their new world. Fortunately, most of the problems they experience in the first few days after birth are generally minor and soon resolved. Jaundice. More than half of all newborn babies develop jaundice, which is a yellow tinge to the skin and eyes. Signs generally develop after the first 24 hours and peak about 5 to 7 days after birth. The condition may last several weeks. A baby develops jaundice with bilirubin, which is produced by the breakdown of red blood cells, accumulates faster than the liver can break it down and pass it from the body. Jaundice may occur for a few reasons. Bilirubin is produced more quickly than the liver can handle. The baby's developing liver isn't able to remove bilirubin from the blood. Too much of the bilirubin is reabsorbed from the intestines before the baby gets rid of it in a bowel movement. Treatment. All newborns are screened for jaundice, either using a skin sensor or with laboratory testing. Mild jaundice generally doesn't require treatment, but more severe cases can require a newborn to stay longer in the hospital. Jaundice may be treated in several ways. You may be asked to feed the baby more frequently, which increases the amount of bilirubin passed out of the body via bowel movements. A doctor may place your baby under a bilirubin light. This treatment, called phototherapy, is quite common. A special lamp helps rid the body of excess bilirubin. Rarely, if the bilirubin level becomes extremely high, intravenous IV fluids or a specialized blood transfusion may be required. Eating problems. Whether you choose to breastfeed or bottle feed, during the first few days after your baby's birth, you may find it difficult to interest your newborn in eating. The first feedings can sometimes be difficult. If this is the case, you're not alone. Remember, your baby is learning, and so are you. See the next chapter for advice on how to reduce the stress of early feedings. If things aren't going well, or if you're concerned that your baby isn't getting enough nourishment, talk to your baby's nurse or doctor. Some babies are slow eaters the first few days, but soon they catch on and breastfeed or bottle feed with enthusiasm. Over the first week, a newborn may lose up to 10% of his or her birth weight and will typically gain that weight back in the first 2 weeks of life. Infection. A newborn's immune system isn't adequately developed to fight infection. Therefore, any type of infection can be more serious for newborns than for older children or adults. If things don't seem right, if your newborn seems too fussy or too sleepy, or if your newborn has a fever, a temperature of 100.4 Fahrenheit or higher, don't delay seeking care. This may mean going to the emergency room if the illness occurs in the middle of the night. Serious bacterial infections, which are uncommon, can invade any organ or the blood, urine, or spinal fluid. Prompt treatment with antibiotics is necessary. But even with early diagnosis and treatment, a newborn infection can be life-threatening. For this reason, medical providers are often quick to treat a possible or suspected infection. Antibiotics often are given early and stopped only when an infection doesn't seem likely. Although the majority of the test results come back showing no evidence of infection, it's better to err on the side of safety by quickly treating a baby than to risk not treating a baby with an infection soon enough. If a mom tested positive for Group B streptococcus near the end of her pregnancy or was diagnosed with an infection in labor, this may influence the decision to start the baby on antibiotics in the hospital. Viral infections can occur in newborns, although they're less common than our bacterial infections. Certain newborn viral infections, such as herpes, varicella, HIV, and cytomegalovirus, may be treated with antiviral medication. Hernias. It's not unusual for a baby to be born with a hernia. Hernias can occur either in the groin area, inguinal hernia, or near the belly button, umbilical hernia. Inguinal hernia. An inguinal hernia is more common in boys than in girls. An inguinal hernia is caused by a weakness in the lower abdominal wall that allows the intestines to bulge forward. The hernia appears as a swelling in the lower abdomen or groin and is generally painless. Sometimes the hernia is visible only when an infant is crying, coughing, or straining during a bowel movement. An inguinal hernia may be small at first, but it tends to gradually enlarge so that an operation is eventually needed to repair the weak spot. An inguinal hernia usually won't go away by itself. Umbilical hernia. An umbilical hernia occurs when part of the intestine protrudes through an opening in the upper abdominal muscles near the belly button. It may be especially evident when an infant cries, causing the baby's belly button to protrude. This is a classic sign of an umbilical hernia. Most umbilical hernias close on their own by the time a baby reaches 1 year old, though some take longer to heal. Umbilical hernias that don't disappear by age 4 or those that appear later in a person's life may require surgical repair to prevent complications. circumcision. If you have a baby boy, one of the decisions you'll face soon after birth is whether to have him circumcised. Circumcision is an elective surgical procedure performed to remove the skin covering the tip of the penis. Knowing about the procedure's potential benefits and risks can help you make an informed decision. Issues to consider. Although circumcision is common in the United States, it's still somewhat controversial. According to the American Academy of Pediatrics, current evidence of the medical benefits of circumcision outweigh the risks. However, the benefits may be low for most baby boys, so it is an elective procedure. Consider your own cultural, religious, and social values in making this decision. For some people, such as those of the Jewish or Islamic faith, circumcision is a religious ritual. For others, it's a matter of personal hygiene or preventive health. Some parents choose circumcision because they don't want their son to look different from his family or peers. As you decide what's best for you and your son, consider these potential health benefits and risks. Benefits of circumcision. Some research suggests that circumcision provides certain benefits. These include decreased risk of urinary tract infections. Although the risk of urinary tract infections in the first year is low, studies suggest that such infections may be up to 10 times more common in uncircumcised baby boys than in those who are circumcised. Uncircumcised boys are also more likely to be admitted to the hospital for a severe urinary tract infection during the first 3 months of life than are those who are circumcised. Decreased risk of cancer of the penis. While this type of cancer is very rare, circumcised men show a lower incidence of cancer of the penis than do uncircumcised men. Decreased risk of some sexually transmitted infections. Studies have shown a lower risk of human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, human papillomavirus, HPV, and herpes simplex virus, HSV, infections in circumcised men. However, safe sexual practices are much more important in the prevention of sexually transmitted infections than is circumcision. Prevention of penile problems. Occasionally, the foreskin on an uncircumcised penis may narrow to the point where it's difficult or impossible to retract, phimosis. A narrowed foreskin can also lead to inflammation of the head of the penis, balanitis. While circumcision can help prevent these issues, they can still occur from the remaining foreskin in some circumcised boys. Ease of hygiene. Circumcision makes it easy to wash the penis, but even if the foreskin is intact, it's still quite simple to keep the penis clean. Normally, the foreskin adheres to the end of the penis in a newborn, then gradually stretches back during early childhood. Risks of circumcision. Circumcision is generally considered a safe procedure, but there are some minor drawbacks to consider. Risks of minor surgery. All surgical procedures, including circumcision, carry certain risks, such as excessive bleeding and infection. There's also the possibility that the foreskin may be cut too short or too long, or that it doesn't heal properly. Pain during the procedure. Circumcision does cause pain. Typically, a local anesthetic is used to block the nerve sensations. Talk to your medical provider about the anesthesia process. Cost. Some insurers don't cover the cost of circumcision. If you're considering circumcision, check whether your insurance company will cover it. Complicating factors. Sometimes circumcision may need to be postponed, such as if your baby is born prematurely, has severe jaundice, or is feeding poorly. It also may not be feasible in certain situations, such as in the rare instance when baby's urethral opening is in an abnormal position. Hypospadias. Other conditions that may prevent circumcision include ambiguous genitalia or a family history of bleeding disorders. Circumcision doesn't affect fertility. There's no evidence to suggest that sexual function or satisfaction is negatively affected by circumcision. Whatever your choice, negative outcomes are rare. how it's done. If you decide to have your son circumcised, his medical provider can answer questions about the procedure and help you make arrangements at your hospital or clinic. Usually, circumcision is performed before you and your son leave the hospital. At times, it's done in an outpatient setting. The procedure itself takes about 10 minutes. Typically, your son lies on his back with his arms and legs restrained. After the penis and surrounding area are cleansed, a local anesthetic is injected into the base of the penis. A special clamp or plastic ring is attached to the penis, and the foreskin is cut away. An ointment, such as petroleum jelly, is applied. This protects the penis from adhering to the diaper. If your newborn is fussy as the anesthetic wears off, hold him gently, being careful to avoid putting pressure on the penis. It usually takes about 7 to 10 days for the penis to heal. Circumcision care. The tip of your son's penis may seem raw for the first week after the procedure, or a yellowish mucus or crust may form around the area. This is a normal part of healing. A small amount of bleeding also is common the first day or two. Clean the diaper area gently and apply a liberal amount of petroleum jelly to the end of the penis with each diaper change. This will keep the diaper from sticking while the penis heals. If there's a bandage, change it with each diapering. At some hospitals, a plastic ring is used instead of a bandage. The ring will remain on the end of the penis until the edge of the circumcision is healed, usually within a week. The ring will drop off on its own. It's okay to wash the penis as it's healing. Problems after a circumcision are rare, but call your baby's medical provider in the following situations. Your baby has trouble urinating 12 to 18 hours after the circumcision. Bleeding or redness around the tip of the penis is persistent. The penis tip is significantly swollen. A foul-smelling drainage comes from the penis tip, or there are crusted sores that contain fluid. The ring is still in place 2 weeks after the circumcision. Screening tests. Before your baby leaves the hospital, a small amount of his or her blood will be taken and sent to the state health department or a private laboratory working in collaboration with the state laboratory. This sample, which may be taken from a vein in your baby's arm or a tiny nick on the heel, is analyzed to detect the presence of rare but important genetic diseases. This testing is referred to as newborn screening. The purpose of the testing is to identify babies who might be at risk and enable families to access relevant treatment and resources. Results are generally available in 1 to 2 weeks. Occasionally, a baby needs to have the test repeated. Don't be alarmed if this happens to your newborn. To ensure that every newborn with any of these conditions is identified, even borderline results are rechecked. Retesting is especially common for premature babies. Each state independently operates its newborn screening program, resulting in slight differences between the tests offered. Current national recommendations include a panel of tests to check for 35 core disorders and 26 secondary disorders. Some states check for additional diseases. You also may request a specific genetic test if you feel your child may be at risk of a certain genetic disorder. Newborn screening. Some of the diseases that can be detected by the panel include biotinidase deficiency. This deficiency is caused by the lack of an enzyme called biotinidase. Signs and symptoms of the disorder include seizures, developmental delay, eczema, and hearing loss. With early diagnosis and treatment, all signs and symptoms can be prevented. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia, CAH. This group of disorders is caused by a deficiency of certain hormones. Signs and symptoms may include lethargy, vomiting, muscle weakness, and dehydration. Infants with mild forms are at risk of reproductive and growth difficulties. Severe cases can cause kidney dysfunction and even death. Lifelong hormone treatment can suppress the condition. Congenital hypothyroidism. About 1 in 3,000 babies has a thyroid hormone deficiency that slows growth and brain development. Left untreated, it can result in mental retardation and stunted growth. With early detection and treatment, healthy development is possible. Cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis causes the body to produce abnormally thickened mucus secretions in the lungs and digestive system. Signs and symptoms generally include salty-tasting skin, poor weight gain, and eventually persistent coughing and shortness of breath. Affected newborns can develop life-threatening lung infections and intestinal obstructions. With early detection and treatment, infants diagnosed with cystic fibrosis now often live longer and in better health than infants diagnosed in the past. Galactosemia. Babies born with galactosemia can't metabolize a sugar found in milk, galactose. Although newborns with this condition typically appear otherwise healthy, they may develop vomiting, diarrhea, jaundice, and liver damage within a few weeks of their first milk feedings. Left untreated, the disorders may result in mental disabilities, blindness, growth failure, and in severe cases, death. Treatment includes eliminating milk and all other dairy products from the diet. Homocystinuria. Caused by an enzyme deficiency, homocystinuria can lead to eye problems, mental disabilities, skeletal abnormalities, and abnormal blood clotting. With early detection and management, including a special diet and dietary supplements, growth and development should be normal. Maple syrup urine disease, MSUD. This disorder affects the metabolism of amino acids. Newborns with this condition typically appear healthy, but by the first week of life, they experience feeding difficulties, lethargy, and poor growth. Left untreated, MSUD can lead to coma or death. Medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase, MCAD deficiency. This rare hereditary disease results from the lack of an enzyme required to convert fat to energy. Babies with MCAD deficiency develop serious vomiting, lethargy that can worsen into coma, seizures, liver failure, and severely low blood sugar. With early detection and monitoring, the condition can be effectively managed. Phenylketonuria, PKU. Babies with PKU retain excessive amounts of phenylalanine, an amino acid found in the protein of almost all foods. Without treatment, PKU can cause mental and motor disabilities, poor growth rate, and seizures. With early detection and treatment, growth and development should be normal. Sickle cell disease. This inherited disease prevents blood cells from circulating easily throughout the body. Infants with sickle cell disease experience an increased susceptibility to infection and slow growth rates. The disease can cause bouts of pain and damage to vital organs, such as the lungs, kidneys, and brain. With early medical treatment, the complications of sickle cell disease can be minimized. Hearing screening. While your baby is in the hospital, he or she may have a hearing test. Although hearing tests are not done routinely at every hospital, newborn hearing screening is becoming widely available. The testing can detect possible hearing loss in the first days of a baby's life. If possible hearing loss is found, further tests may be done to confirm the results. Two tests are used to screen a newborn's hearing. Both are quick, about 10 minutes, and painless, and can be done while your baby sleeps. One test measures how the brain responds to sound. Clicks or tones are played through soft earphones into the baby's ears, while electrodes taped on the baby's head measure the brain's response. Another test measures specific responses to sound waves that enter a baby's ear. As clicks or tones are played into a baby's ear, a probe placed inside the ear canal measures the response. Critical congenital heart defect, CCHD screening. Before leaving the hospital, your baby will likely also be screened for any heart defects. Ultrasounds can identify many heart defects during a pregnancy. However, some issues may be missed or cannot be detected until after a baby is born. For this test, an oxygen sensor, pulse oximeter is placed on your baby's hands or feet. The test is quick and does not cause discomfort to your baby. If the oxygen levels are low or different on the right and left sides, your baby's medical provider will most likely recommend additional testing. Chapter 3, Feeding Your Baby. If it seems like all you do at first is feed your baby, you know what? You're right. Newborns may not eat a lot, but they eat often. And in those first few weeks with your new son or daughter, much of your life will revolve around satisfying his or her hunger. Just when you think you have a moment to relax, or perhaps fit in a shower, wouldn't you know it, your little one wants to eat again. At first, all of these feedings may seem exhausting. For almost every new parent, early days with a newborn can be demanding and sometimes stressful. Both you and your baby are adapting to a new reality, and that typically takes time. Throughout this adjustment, remember that feeding your newborn is about more than just nourishment. It's a time of cuddling and closeness that helps build the connection between you and your baby. You want to make every feeding a time to bond with your baby. Cherish this time before your baby is old enough to start feeding himself or herself. That time will come soon enough. Breast milk or formula? Some families know right from the start what they'll feed their babies, breast milk or formula, while others struggle. Most child health organizations advocate breastfeeding, and breast is best is a commonly used phrase. There's no doubt breastfeeding is a wonderful way to nourish a newborn. Breast milk provides numerous benefits. Mayo Clinic experts agree. However, medical providers also realize that not all women are the same, and people's life situations are different. Depending on your circumstances, certain factors may lead you to choose infant formula instead of breast milk. Or you may opt for a combination of both breast milk and formula. Some women simply aren't able to breastfeed. If you're worried that you're not being a good mother or putting the needs of your child first if you don't breastfeed, don't. Such negative thinking isn't good for you or for your baby. Feeding, regardless of how it's delivered, breast milk or formula, breast or bottle, promotes intimacy. Know that both options will provide your child the nutrition he or she needs to grow and thrive. Questions to ask. If you haven't had your baby yet and you're debating between breast milk and formula, you might consider these questions. What does your medical provider suggest? Your medical provider will likely be very supportive of breastfeeding, unless you have specific health issues, such as a certain disease or disease treatment that make formula feeding a better choice. Do you understand both methods? Many women have misconceptions about breastfeeding. Learn as much as you can about feeding your baby. Seek out expert advice if needed. Do you plan to return to work? If so, how will that impact breastfeeding? Does your place of work have accommodations available where you can use a breast pump, if that's your plan? How does your partner feel about the decision? The decision is ultimately yours, but it's a good idea to take your partner's feelings into consideration. How have other mothers you trust and respect made their decisions? If they had it to do over again, would they make the same choices? Breastfeeding. Breastfeeding is highly encouraged by experts because it has many known health benefits for babies and moms. The longer you breastfeed, the greater the chances that your baby will experience these benefits and the more likely they are to last. Benefits for babies. Breast milk provides babies with ideal nutrition. Breast milk has just the right nutrients in just the right amounts to nourish your baby completely. It contains the fats, proteins, carbohydrates, vitamins, and minerals that a baby needs for growth, digestion, and brain development. Breast milk is also individualized. The composition of your breast milk changes as your baby grows. Protection against disease. Breast milk provides antibodies that help your baby's immune system fight off common childhood illnesses. Breastfed babies may have fewer colds, ear infections, and urinary tract infections than do babies who aren't breastfed. Breastfed babies may also have fewer problems with asthma, food allergies, and skin conditions, such as eczema. They may be less likely to experience a reduction in the number of red blood cells, anemia. Research suggests that breastfeeding might also help to protect against sudden infant death syndrome, SIDS, and it may offer a slight reduction in the risk of childhood leukemia. Breast milk may even protect against disease long-term. Studies suggest that adults who were breastfed as infants may have a lower risk of heart attack and stroke and may be less likely to develop diabetes. Protection against obesity. Research indicates that babies who are breastfed are less likely to experience obesity as adults. Formula-fed infants generally have a higher calorie intake than do babies fed breast milk. And breast milk itself appears to have components that help control hunger and energy balance. Easy digestion. Breast milk is easier for babies to digest than is formula or cow's milk. Because breast milk doesn't remain in the stomach as long as formula does, breastfed babies spit up less. They have less gas and less constipation. They also have less diarrhea, as breast milk appears to kill some diarrhea-causing germs and helps a baby's digestive system grow and function. Benefits for moms. For nursing mothers, the benefits include faster recovery from childbirth. The baby's suckling triggers your body to release oxytocin, a hormone that causes the uterus to contract. This means that the uterus returns to its pre-pregnancy size more quickly after delivery. Suppressed ovulation. Breastfeeding delays the return of ovulation and therefore menstruation, which may help extend the time between pregnancies. However, breastfeeding is not a guarantee against pregnancy. You can still become pregnant while breastfeeding. Possible long-term health benefits. Breastfeeding may reduce your risk of getting breast cancer before menopause. Breastfeeding also appears to provide some protection from uterine and ovarian cancers. Convenience. Many mothers find breastfeeding to be more convenient than bottle feeding. It can be done anywhere, at any time, whenever your baby shows signs of hunger. Plus, no equipment is necessary. Breast milk is always available and at the perfect temperature because you don't need to prepare a bottle. And you can nurse lying down. Nighttime feedings may be easier. Cost savings. Breastfeeding can save money because you don't need to buy formula and you may not need bottles. Challenges. Admittedly, breastfeeding can also present some challenges and inconveniences. Drawbacks to breastfeeding for nursing moms include exclusive feeding duties. At first, newborns nurse every 2 to 3 hours, day and night. That can be tiring for you, and your partner may feel left out. But you can also express milk with a breast pump if desired, which can let others take over some feedings. Certain dietary restrictions. If you're breastfeeding, the general rule is to avoid drinking alcohol before nursing. The alcohol level in breast milk is basically the same as in your bloodstream. One standard drink, such as 5 ounces of wine or 12 ounces of beer, takes about 2 to 3 hours to leave the bloodstream, and therefore breast milk. If you do drink alcohol, wait at least a couple of hours before breastfeeding. Pumping and dumping. Pumping after drinking alcohol and discarding the breast milk doesn't affect the amount of alcohol in breast milk. Blood alcohol levels will only go down with time. Sore nipples. Some women may experience sore nipples and at times breast infections. These may be avoided with the right positioning and technique. A lactation consultant or your medical provider can advise you on proper positioning. Other physical side effects. When you're lactating, your body's hormones may keep your vagina relatively dry. Using a water-based lubricating jelly can help treat this problem. It may also take time for your menstrual cycle to once again establish a regular pattern. What goes in comes out. While you're breastfeeding, keep in mind that the foods and other items you ingest can be passed on to your baby through your breast milk. A few things to remember while breastfeeding. Avoid or limit alcohol. If you do have an occasional drink, keep it to a minimal amount and do it right after breastfeeding. Limit caffeine. Drink mainly caffeine-free beverages. Check your medications. Most are safe to take, but consult your baby's medical provider first. Only rarely do the foods you eat cause your baby to be fussy or gassy. Babies can get fussy for many reasons, and they can experience gas from the air they swallow when they cry or eat. However, if you suspect your child may be intolerant to something you ate, try eliminating the food for a while and see how your baby responds. Milk production. As an expectant mother, your milk-producing mammary glands prepare for nursing even before your baby is born. By about the sixth month of pregnancy, your breasts are ready to produce milk. Your milk supply gradually increases between the third and fifth days after your baby's birth. As the milk-producing glands fill with milk, your breasts will be full and sometimes tender. They may also feel lumpy or hard, engorged. Milk is released from the glands when your baby nurses. The milk is propelled down milk ducts, which are located just behind the dark circle of tissue that surrounds the nipple, areola. The sucking action of the baby compresses the areola, forcing milk out through tiny openings in the nipple. The baby's sucking stimulates nerve endings in the areola and nipple, sending a message to the brain to release the hormone oxytocin. Oxytocin acts on the milk-producing glands in the breasts, causing the ejection of milk to the nursing baby. This release is called the letdown reflex, which may be accompanied by a tingling sensation. Although your baby's sucking is the main stimulus for the letdown reflex, other stimuli can have the same effect. For example, hearing a baby cry, or even thoughts of your baby, or the sounds of rippling water, may set things in motion. The timing of this reflex can sometimes be inconvenient if you're not ready to breastfeed at the moment. Regardless of whether your plan is to breastfeed, your body produces milk after childbirth. After that, your milk supply is based on demand. If you decide not to breastfeed, your milk supply eventually goes away. If you do breastfeed, the more frequently your breasts are emptied, the more milk they produce. Getting started. The time to begin breastfeeding is right after your baby is born. If possible, put baby to your breast in the delivery room. Early skin-to-skin contact is known to improve breastfeeding outcomes. Breastfeeding may be a natural process, but that doesn't mean it comes easily to all mothers. Breastfeeding is a new skill for both mom and baby. Nothing can really prepare your nipples for a nursing baby. If this is your first child, you may feel uncertain holding your baby, let alone putting him or her to your breast. It may take a few attempts before you and your baby get the hang of it. While you're in the hospital, ask a lactation consultant or nurse to assist you. These experts can provide hands-on instruction and helpful hints. After you leave the hospital or birthing center, you might want to arrange for a public health nurse who is knowledgeable about infant feeding or a certified lactation consultant to visit you for additional one-on-one instruction. It's a good idea to take a class on breastfeeding. Often, information on breastfeeding is offered as part of childbirth classes, or you may be able to sign up for a class. Most hospitals and birthing centers offer classes on feeding a newborn. Supplies to have on hand. If possible, purchase a couple of high-quality nursing bras. They provide important support for lactating breasts. What distinguishes nursing bras from regular bras is that both cups open to the front, usually with a simple maneuver that you can manage unobtrusively while you hold your baby. You may also want nursing pads, which sit inside the bra to absorb milk that leaks from your breasts. Options include disposable pads or washable and reusable versions. Avoid those with plastic shields, which prevent air circulation around the nipples. Nursing pads can be worn continuously or on occasion. Some women don't bother with the pads, but most women find them helpful. Get comfortable. When it's feeding time, find a quiet location and take advantage of this time with your baby. Get into a position that's comfortable for both you and baby. If you're taking a seated position, it helps to sit up straight. Put a pillow behind the small of your back and one under your arms for support. A nursing pillow that wraps around your body can also make breastfeeding more comfortable by raising your baby to your breast. Hold your baby across your body so that he or she faces your breast, with his or her mouth near your nipple. Make sure your baby's whole body is facing you, tummy to tummy, with ear, shoulder, and hip in a straight line. Place your free hand up under your breast to support it while squeezing lightly to point the nipple straight forward. Different women find different nursing positions most comfortable. Experiment with the positions to see which works best for you. A good latch. When your baby connects or latches well to your breast, he or she can nurse effectively, and your breast feels little discomfort. To help your baby get a good latch, hold your baby close and brush your nipple against your baby's cheek to trigger the rooting reflex. The motion your baby makes while searching for your nipple. If your baby is hungry and interested in nursing, his or her mouth should open and he or she will turn toward your breast. When this happens, bring your baby's mouth to your nipple. You want your baby to receive as much nipple and areola as possible, and your baby's lips to flare out with chin and cheeks touching your breast. As your baby starts suckling and your nipple is being stretched in your baby's mouth, you may feel some surging sensations. After a few suckles, those sensations should subside. If they don't, or if you have pain, sandwich the breast more and draw baby's head in more closely. If that doesn't produce comfort, gently remove baby from your breast, taking care to release the suction first. To break the suction, gently insert the tip of your finger into the corner of your baby's mouth. Slowly push your finger between your baby's gums until you feel the release. Repeat the procedure until your baby has latched on properly. You want there to be a firm bond of suction. You'll know that milk is flowing and your baby is swallowing if there's a strong, steady, rhythmic motion visible in your baby's cheek. Also, listen for the K sound of your baby's swallowing. If your breast is blocking your baby's nose, elevating your baby slightly or angling the baby's head back and in may help provide a little breathing room. If your baby attaches and sucks correctly, even if the arrangement feels awkward at first, the position is correct. Once nursing begins, you can relax the supporting arm and pull your baby's lower body closer to you. Feeding positions. Cross cradle hold. Bring your baby across the front of your body, tummy to tummy. Hold your baby with the arm opposite to the breast you're feeding with. Support the back of the baby's head with your open hand. This hold allows you especially good control as you position your baby to latch on. With your free hand, support your breast from the underside in a U-shaped hold to align with baby's mouth. Cradle hold. Cradle your baby in your arm, with your baby's head resting comfortably in the crook of your elbow on the same side as the breast you're feeding with. Your forearm supports your baby's back. Use your free hand to support your breast. Football, clutch hold. In this position, you hold your baby in much the same way a running back tucks a football under his arm. Hold your baby at your side on one arm, with your elbow bent and your open hand firmly supporting your baby's head, face up at the level of your breast. Your baby's torso will rest on your forearm. Put a pillow at your side to support your arm. A chair with broad, low arms works best. With your free hand, support your breast from the underside in a C-shaped hold to align with baby's mouth. Because the baby isn't positioned near the abdomen, the football hold is popular among mothers recovering from C-sections. It's also a frequent choice of women who have large breasts or who are nursing premature or small babies. Side-lying hold. Although most new mothers learn to breastfeed in a sitting position, at times you may prefer to nurse while lying down. Use the hand of your lower arm to help keep your baby's head positioned at your breast. With your upper arm in hand, reach across your body and grasp your breast, touching your nipple to your baby's lips. After your baby latches on firmly, you can use your lower arm to support your own head and your upper hand and arm to help support your baby. How often should you nurse? Because breast milk is easily digested, breastfed babies usually are hungry every few hours at first. During those early days, breastfeeding may start to feel like a marathon session. Most newborns eat 8 to 12 times a day, about every 2 to 3 hours. By 6 to 8 weeks after birth, your baby will probably begin to go longer between feedings. During growth spurts, your baby may take more at each feeding or want to breastfeed more often. Trust your body's ability to keep up with the increased demand. How long should a nursing session be? In general, let your baby nurse as long as he or she wants. The length of feedings may vary considerably. However, on average, a nursing session may take about half an hour for most babies. Offer your baby both breasts at each feeding. Allow your baby to end the feeding on the first side. Then, after burping your baby, offer the other side. Alternate starting sides to equalize the stimulation each breast receives. You want baby to finish one breast before switching to the other side because the milk that comes first from your breast, called the foremilk, is rich in protein for growth. But the longer your baby sucks, the more he or she gets the hind milk, which is rich in calories and fat, and therefore helps your baby gain weight and grow. So wait until your baby seems ready to quit before offering him or her your other breast. Is my baby getting enough? A baby's need for frequent feeding usually isn't a sign that baby isn't getting enough. It more likely reflects the easy digestibility of breast milk. If your baby is satisfied after feeding and is growing, you can be confident that you're doing well. If you're concerned that baby may not be getting enough milk, ask yourself, is baby gaining weight? Steady weight gain is often the most reliable sign that a baby is getting enough to eat. Although most babies lose weight soon after birth, it's typically regained, and then some, within 10 days to 2 weeks. Can I hear baby swallowing? Listen carefully, and you'll be able to hear your baby swallowing. Also, look for a strong, steady, rhythmic motion in your baby's lower jaw, or even a bit of milk dribbling out of your baby's mouth. How do my breasts feel? When your baby is latched on successfully, you'll feel a gentle pulling sensation on your breast, rather than a pinching or biting sensation on your nipple. Your breasts may feel firm or full before the feeding, and then softer or emptier afterward. What about baby's diapers? By the fourth day after birth, expect your baby to have 6 to 8 wet diapers a day. Also expect regular bowel movements. The stool will be dark and sticky for the first couple of days, eventually becoming seedy, loose, and golden yellow. Does baby seem healthy? A baby who seems satisfied after feedings and is alert and active at other times is likely getting enough milk. Also, look for a healthy skin tone. Breast care. As you start to breastfeed, you may experience some occasional problems. Though these can be uncomfortable, they often go away with time or can be easily treated. Fullness. A few days after your baby is born, your breasts may become full, firm, and tender, making it challenging for your baby to grasp your nipple. This swelling, called engorgement, also causes congestion within your breasts, which makes your milk flow slower. So even if your baby can latch on, he or she may be less than satisfied with the results. To manage engorgement, express some milk using a breast pump or by hand before trying to breastfeed. Support with one hand the breast you intend to express. With your other hand, gently stroke your breast inward toward your areola. Then place your thumb and forefinger at the top and bottom of the breast, just behind the areola. As you gently compress the breast between your fingers, milk should flow or squirt out of the nipple. Taking a warm shower also may result in letdown of milk and provide some engorgement relief. You can also use a breast pump to express some milk. As you release your milk, you'll begin to feel your areola and nipple soften. Once enough milk is released, your baby can comfortably latch on and nurse. Frequent, lengthy nursing sessions are the best means to avoid engorgement. Nurse your baby regularly and try not to miss a feeding. Wearing a nursing bra both day and night will help support engorged breasts and make you feel more comfortable. If your breasts are sore after nursing, apply an ice pack to reduce swelling. Some women find that a warm shower also relieves breast tenderness. Fortunately, the period of engorgement is usually brief, lasting no more than a few days after delivery. Nipple discomfort. At first, you may experience some initial nipple discomfort as baby latches on, but the discomfort should subside as your baby feeds. For some women, though, breastfeeding can be downright painful. If so, the first step is to check that your baby is latching on correctly. Sore or cracked nipples are usually caused by incorrect positioning and latching. At each feeding, you want to make sure that the baby has the areola and not just the nipple in his or her mouth. You also want to be certain that your baby's head isn't out of line with his or her body. This position causes pulling at the nipple. To care for your nipples, express milk onto your nipples and let them air dry after each feeding. You don't need to wash your nipples after nursing. There are built-in lubricants around the areola that provide a natural salve. Soap and water with daily bathing is fine. Afterward, let your nipples air dry. Blocked milk ducts. Sometimes, milk ducts in the breast become clogged, causing milk to back up. Blocked ducts can be felt through the skin as small, tender lumps or larger areas of hardness. Because blocked ducts can lead to an infection, you should treat the problem right away. The best way to open up blocked ducts is to let your baby empty the affected breast, offering that breast first at each feeding. If your baby doesn't empty the affected breast, express milk from it by hand or by breast pump. It may also help to apply a warm compress before nursing and to massage the affected breast. If the problem doesn't go away with self-treatment, call a lactation consultant or your medical provider for advice. Breast infection. Infection, mastitis, can occur if some milk remains in your breasts after feedings. Infection may also result when germs gain entry into your milk ducts from cracked nipples and from your baby's mouth. These germs are not harmful to your baby. Everyone has them. They just don't belong in your breast tissues. Mastitis starts with flu-like signs and symptoms, such as a fever, chills, and body aches. Redness, swelling, and breast tenderness then follow. If you develop such signs and symptoms, call your medical provider. You may need antibiotics in addition to rest and more fluids. Keep nursing if you're taking antibiotics. Treatment for mastitis doesn't harm your baby, and emptying your breast during feedings will help to prevent clogged milk ducts, another possible source of mastitis. Applying cold compresses to your breasts after feedings can help soothe swelling. Your medical provider may also recommend taking an over-the-counter pain reliever. Support. If you're having problems breastfeeding, or you're worried that baby isn't getting enough milk, ask for help. If you sense something isn't right, or if breastfeeding seems too painful, don't be afraid to contact your baby's medical provider or a lactation consultant. Most hospitals have lactation consultants on staff who can answer your questions or help you resolve any problems you may encounter. Breastfeeding may feel awkward at first, but you'll get the hang of it. Friends who've breastfed may have valuable insights and provide needed support. You might also consider seeking out a lactation consultant in your area. Look for someone with an International Board Certified Lactation Consultant, IBCLC, credential. Vitamin D. Talk with your baby's medical provider about vitamin D supplements for your baby. Breast milk likely won't provide enough vitamin D, and infant formula may not either. Your baby needs vitamin D to absorb calcium and phosphorus. Too little vitamin D can cause rickets, a softening and weakening of bones. Since sun exposure, an important source of vitamin D, isn't recommended for babies younger than 6 months, supplements are the best way to prevent vitamin D deficiency in infants. The American Academy of Pediatrics recommends that babies who are breastfed or formula-fed receive 400 international units, IU, of liquid vitamin D a day. starting in the first few days after birth. Continue giving your baby vitamin D as long as you breastfeed. If you're using infant formula, continue giving vitamin D supplements until your son or daughter drinks at least 32 ounces of formula a day. As your baby gets older and you add solid foods to his or her diet, you can help your baby meet the daily vitamin D requirement by providing foods that contain vitamin D, such as eggs and fortified foods. Although most babies won't consistently eat these foods during their first year. After age 12 months, you can also offer whole cow's milk. When giving your baby liquid vitamin D, make sure you don't exceed the recommended amount. Carefully read the instructions that come with the supplement and use only the dropper that's provided. Going back to work. With a little planning and preparation, you can do both, breastfeed and return to work. Some nursing mothers work from home, while some arrange to have their babies brought to them for feedings, or they go to their babies. Most, though, rely on the help of a breast pump. Using a double breast pump is the most effective way to pump. A double breast pump requires about 15 minutes of pumping every 3 to 4 hours. If you need to increase your milk supply, nurse and pump more often. Some women pump primarily at home. You might pump after the morning feeding and after the feeding when you return from work, as long as all of your milk produced in 24 hours is removed either by your baby or from pumping, you'll maintain a good supply. Many women also pump while at work, storing the milk and saving it for the next day. If you're planning to pump at work, talk to your employer as early as possible. Ask about access to a clean, private space, not a bathroom, with a comfortable chair and an outlet. You'll also need a cooler bag, refrigerator, or freezer in which to store expressed milk, and a place to rinse out pump parts. For the most part, employers are becoming more aware of the needs of working mothers and are willing to work together to help new moms stay productive. Weaning. There will come a time when it's best for baby and you to transition from the breast to a cup. Your baby is growing up, and he or she is ready to take the next big step. Or if your child is not ready for a cup, you may need to transition your child from the breast to a bottle. You may have mixed emotions about weaning, but you can smooth the transition by taking a gradual approach and offering plenty of love and affection. Choose the right time and do what you can to make it a growing experience. Timing. You may wonder when's the best time to start weaning. There really isn't a right or wrong answer. Experts recommend exclusively breastfeeding babies for the first 6 months and continuing until your baby is 1 year old. Breast milk contains the right balance of nutrients for your baby and boosts your baby's immune system. Still, when to start weaning your child is a personal decision. It's often easiest to begin weaning when your baby initiates the process, which may be sooner or later than you expect. The process of weaning often begins naturally at 6 months old, when solid foods are typically introduced and feeding sessions start to become less frequent. Some children begin to gradually turn away from breast milk and seek other forms of nutrition and comfort at around age 1. When they've begun eating a wide variety of solid foods and may be able to drink from a cup. Other children may not initiate weaning until their toddler years, when they become less willing to sit still during breastfeeding. You may also decide when to start the weaning process yourself. This may be more difficult than following your child's lead, but can be done with some extra care and sensitivity. Resist comparing your situation with that of other families, and consider rethinking any deadlines you may have set for weaning when you were pregnant or when your baby was a newborn. You might consider delaying weaning if your child isn't feeling well or is teething. He or she will be more likely to handle the transition well if you're both in good health. You might consider also postponing weaning if a major life change has occurred, such as moving to a new home or starting a new job. You don't want to add more stress at what may already be a stressful time for you and your child. Some research suggests that exclusive breastfeeding for at least 4 months may have a protective effect for children who have had a family history of food allergies. If food allergies run in your family, talk to your child's doctor about the potential benefits of delaying weaning. Method. When you start the weaning process, take it slow. Eliminate one breastfeeding session a day, every 2 to 3 days. Slowly tapering off the number of times you breastfeed each day will cause your milk supply to gradually diminish and prevent any discomfort from engorgement. Children tend to be more attached to the first and last feedings of the day, when the need for comfort is greater. So it might be helpful to drop a midday breastfeeding session first. You might also choose to wean your baby from breast milk during the day, but continue breastfeeding at night. It's up to you and your child. When eliminating a breastfeeding session, offer an alternate activity, such as a book, toy, or other fun activity. Depending on your approach, weaning could take days, weeks, or months. Remember, however, that slower is better. Rushing the weaning process may be upsetting for your child and cause engorgement for you. Ongoing nutrition. If you wean your child before age 1, substitute breast milk with iron-fortified formula. Ask your child's medical provider to recommend a formula. Don't give your child cow's milk until after his or her first birthday. You can wean your child to a bottle and then a cup, or if your child seems ready, directly to a cup. If you're introducing your child to a bottle for the first time, do so at a time when your child isn't extremely hungry and may have more patience. It also may help if a separate caregiver introduces the bottle, since some children may refuse a bottle when the opportunity to breastfeed is nearby. Choose a bottle nipple with a slow flow at first. If you use a bottle nipple with a fast flow, your child may become frustrated with a slower flow of milk during breastfeeding, or overwhelmed by the fast flow from the bottle. Pumping breast milk. If you're returning to work or would like to share feeding duties with your partner, pumping breast milk is a useful option. It allows your baby to continue receiving your breast milk even when you're not there. It may help to nurse exclusively during the first few weeks so that you and your baby learn how to breastfeed and so that your milk supply becomes well established. Once you feel confident that the two of you are doing well with breastfeeding, you can begin to introduce your baby to breast milk in a bottle. However, some women begin pumping soon after birth and do just fine. Initially, pump a few times after regular feedings to start building a small stockpile. Consider replacing one or two daytime feedings with a bottle of breast milk. Keep in mind that the feel of a bottle nipple in a baby's mouth is different from that of your breast. The way a baby sucks from a bottle nipple also is different, so it may take some practice to make the switch. It may also help to have someone besides you offer the bottle, since baby is likely to associate your voice and scent with breastfeeding. Choosing a pump. Most mothers who breastfeed find using a breast pump easier than expressing milk manually. A lactation consultant or your baby's medical provider can help you determine what type of pump, manual or electric, is best for you, and offer help and support if problems arise. In deciding on a pump, here are some factors to consider. How often will you use the breast pump? If you'll be away from the baby only occasionally and your milk supply is well established, a simple hand pump may be all you need. They're small and inexpensive. If you're returning to work full-time or planning to be away from your baby for more than a few hours a day, you may want to invest in an electric pump. Will you need to pump as quickly as possible? A typical pumping session lasts about 15 minutes abreast. If you'll be pumping at work or in other time crunch situations, you'll likely want an electric pump that allows you to pump both breasts at once. How much can you afford to spend? While manual models generally cost less than $50, electric pumps that include a carrying case and insulated section for storing milk may cost more than $200. Some hospitals or medical supply stores rent hospital-grade breast pumps. Health insurance plans generally cover the cost of breastfeeding support and supplies. Your insurer may specify what type of breast pump is covered. Is the pump easy to assemble and transport? If the breast pump is difficult to assemble, take apart, or clean, it's bound to be frustrating, which may reduce your enthusiasm for pumping. If you'll be toting the pump to work every day or traveling with the pump, look for a lightweight model. If you'll need to pump away from a power outlet, look for pumps that can run on batteries instead of being plugged in. Some breast pumps come in a carrying case with an insulated section for storing expressed milk. Additionally, some electric models are quieter than our others. If it's important to be discreet, make sure the noise level is acceptable. Is the suction adjustable? What's comfortable for some women may not be for others. Choose a pump that allows you to control the degree of suction. Storing breast milk. Once you start pumping, it's important to know how to safely and properly store your expressed breast milk. Container. Store expressed breast milk in capped glass or plastic containers that have been cleaned in a dishwasher or washed in hot soapy water and thoroughly rinsed. Consider boiling the containers after washing them if the quality of your water supply is questionable. If you store breast milk for 3 days or less, you can also use a plastic bag designed for milk collection and storage. While economical, plastic bags aren't recommended for long-term breast milk storage because they may spill, leak, and become contaminated more easily than hard-sided containers. Also, certain components of breast milk may adhere to the soft plastic bags during long-term breast milk storage, which could deprive your baby of essential nutrients. Method. You can store expressed breast milk in the refrigerator or freezer using waterproof labels and ink. Label each container with a date and time, including your baby's name if you're delivering containers to your baby's care provider. Place the containers in the back of the refrigerator or freezer, where the temperature is the coolest. Use your earliest milk first. To minimize waste, fill individual containers with the amount of milk your baby will need for one feeding. Also, consider storing smaller portions, 1 to 2 ounces, for unexpected situations or delays in regular feedings. Keep in mind that breast milk expands as it freezes, so don't fill containers to the brim. You can add freshly expressed breast milk to refrigerated or frozen milk you expressed earlier in the same day. However, be sure to cool the freshly expressed breast milk in the refrigerator or a cooler with ice packs for at least 1 hour before adding it to previously chilled milk. Don't add warm breast milk to frozen breast milk because it will cause the frozen milk to partially thaw. Keep milk expressed on different days in separate containers. During storage, expressed breast milk will typically separate. The thick white cream will rise to the top of the container. Before feeding your baby, gently swirl the contents of the container to ensure that the creamy portion of the milk is evenly distributed. The sooner you use the milk, the better. Some research suggests that the longer you store breast milk, whether in the refrigerator or in the freezer, the greater the loss of vitamin C in the milk. Other studies have shown that refrigeration beyond 2 days may reduce the bacteria-killing properties of breast milk, and long-term freezer storage may lower the quality of breast milk's lipids. Storing breast milk. At room temperature, fresh milk, best within 4 hours, especially in warm temperatures, acceptable up to 6 hours. For thawed, previously frozen, 1 to 2 hours. Leftover from a feeding, use within 2 hours after feeding. For insulated cooler with ice packs, fresh milk can last up to 24 hours. Thawed, previously frozen, 1 to 2 hours. Leftover from a feeding, use within 2 hours after feeding. Breast milk stored at refrigeration, 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Best within 4 days. Acceptable within 8 days if cleanly expressed and stored in back of refrigerator. For thawed previously frozen, up to 24 hours. Leftover from a feeding, use within 2 hours after feeding. For storing in the freezer, 0 degrees Fahrenheit or colder, fresh is best within 9 months, acceptable within 12 months if stored in back of deep freezer. thawed previously frozen, never refreeze. Left over from a feeding? Use within 2 hours after feeding. Thawing. Thaw the oldest milk first. Simply place the frozen container in the refrigerator the night before you intend to use it. Or place the container under warm running water or in a bowl of warm water. Avoid letting the water touch the mouth of the container. Never thaw frozen breast milk on a counter at room temperature, which enables bacteria to multiply in the milk. Also, don't heat a frozen bottle on the stove or in the microwave. These methods can create an uneven distribution of heat and destroy the milk's antibodies. Use thawed breast milk within 24 hours. Discard any remaining milk. Don't refreeze thawed or partially thawed breast milk. Thawed breast milk may smell or taste different from freshly expressed milk due to the breakdown of milk fats, but it's still safe for your baby to drink. The milk may separate, so you may need to gently swirl the thawed milk so that it's mixed evenly. Feeding tips. As your baby matures, he or she will gradually need fewer daily feedings and eat more at each feeding. Soon, a feeding pattern will begin to emerge. In the meantime, whether you breastfeed or formula feed, here are a few pointers to keep in mind. Consider feedings a time to bond. For babies, feeding is as much a social activity as a nutritional one. Your baby's growth and development are based in part on the powerful bond that forms during feedings. Take the opportunity to put away your phone or tablet and turn off the television. Hold your baby close during each feeding. Look him or her in the eyes. Speak with a gentle voice. Don't miss this chance to build your baby's sense of security, trust, and comfort. Feed on cue. The size of your infant's stomach is very small, about the size of his or her fist, and the time it takes to become empty varies from 1 to 3 hours. Feeding on cue requires you to watch for signs that baby is ready to eat. Your baby makes sucking movements with his or her mouth or tongue, rooting, sucks on his or her fist, or makes small sounds. Crying is a late cue for hunger. You will soon be able to distinguish between cries for food and those for other reasons, such as pain, fatigue, or illness. It's important to feed your baby promptly when he or she signals hunger. This helps your baby learn which kinds of discomfort mean hunger and that hunger can be satisfied by sucking, which brings food. If you don't respond promptly, your baby may become so upset that trying to feed at this point may prove more frustrating than satisfying. Let baby set the pace. Avoid rushing your baby during a feeding. Let your baby determine how much and how fast to eat. Many babies, like adults, prefer to eat in a relaxed manner. It's normal for an infant to suck, pause, rest, socialize a bit, and then return to feeding. Some newborns are speedy, efficient eaters, consistently whizzing through feedings. Other babies are grazers, preferring snack-sized feedings at frequent intervals. Your baby will let you know when he or she has had enough to eat. When your baby is satisfied, he or she will stop sucking, close his or her mouth, or turn away from the nipple. Baby may push the nipple out of his or her mouth with his or her tongue, or your baby may arch his or her back if you try to continue feeding. If, however, your baby needs burping or is in the middle of a bowel movement, his or her mind may not be on eating. Wait a bit, and then try offering the breast or bottle again. Feeding a sleepy newborn. Most newborns lose weight in the first few days after birth. Until your newborn regains this lost weight, usually within 1 week after birth, it's important to feed him or her frequently, even if he or she would rather drift off to sleep. You'll no doubt have times when your baby signals that he or she is hungry, only to doze off once you begin feeding. Try these tips to feed a sleepy baby. Watch for and take advantage of your baby's alert stages. Feed at these times. If your baby falls asleep while feeding, gently wake and encourage him or her to finish eating. give your baby a massage by walking your fingers up his or her spine. Partially undress your baby. Because your baby's skin is sensitive to temperature changes, the coolness may wake him or her long enough to eat. Stroke a circle around your baby's lips with a fingertip a few times. Rock your baby in a sitting position. A baby's eyes often open when he or she is positioned upright. Once your newborn establishes a pattern of weight gain and reaches his or her original birth weight, it's generally okay to wait for feedings until he or she wakes up. Be flexible. Don't expect your baby to eat the same amount every day. Babies vary in how much they eat, especially if they're experiencing a growth spurt. At these times, your baby will need and demand more milk and eat more frequently. It may seem like your baby can't get full. During these times, you may need to put your baby to your breast or offer a bottle more often. Babies often don't eat at precise intervals throughout the day. Most babies cluster their feedings at various times of the day and night. It's common for a baby to eat several times within a few hours and then sleep for a few hours. Stick with breast milk or formula. Don't give your newborn water, juice, or other fluids. Introducing these liquids before your baby is 6 months old is unnecessary and can interfere with his or her desire for breast milk or formula, which may lead to malnourishment and risk potentially dangerous electrolyte imbalances. Consider supplements. If you're feeding your baby iron-fortified formula, he or she is likely getting the recommended amount of iron. If you're breastfeeding your baby, start giving your baby an iron supplement at age 4 months. Continue giving your baby the supplement until he or she is eating two or more servings a day of iron-rich foods, such as fortified cereal or pureed meat. If you offer mixed feedings, breast milk and formula, and the majority of your baby's feedings are from formula, the supplement probably isn't necessary. Talk to your baby's medical provider. He or she may also recommend a fluoride supplement, depending on your water supply, and a vitamin D supplement. Formula feeding. Some parents prefer to feed their infants formula rather than breast milk. This is a personal choice, and there are many reasons why new parents opt for formula rather than breast milk. In a few cases, breastfeeding just isn't possible. If you choose not to, or you aren't able to breastfeed, be assured that your baby's nutritional needs can be met with the use of infant formula, and your baby will still be happily bonded to you as a parent. Pros and cons. Parents who formula feed usually feel the main advantages are shared feeding duties. Using a bottle with formula allows more than one person to feed the baby. For that reason, some nursing mothers feel they have more freedom when they're bottle feeding. Both parents may like bottle feeding because it allows them to share more easily in the feeding responsibilities. Convenience. Some parents feel formula is more portable, especially on outings and in public places. They don't have to find an out-of-the-way location to breastfeed. Some of the challenges of formula feeding include time-consuming preparation. Bottles must be prepared for each feeding. You need a steady supply of formula. Bottles and nipples need to be washed. If you go out, you may need to take formula with you. Cost. Formula is costly, which may be a concern for some parents. The right supplies. Make sure you have the right supplies on hand. Staff at the hospital or birthing center can provide bottle feeding equipment and formula the first few days after your baby's birth and show you how to bottle feed your newborn. You don't need a ton of equipment for formula feeding. Generally, it's helpful to have several 4-ounce bottles for the early months and several 8-ounce bottles as your baby grows and wants more at a time. Some extra nipples, rings, and caps, and a bottle brush for cleaning are also nice to have on hand. In addition to buying the right equipment, consider taking a class on infant feeding if you haven't taken one already. Often, information on feeding a newborn is offered as part of childbirth classes. If you've never bottle-fed a baby before, taking a class will help you feel more comfortable when you bring your baby home. Bottles. Bottles generally come in two sizes, 4 ounces and 8 ounces. The 4-ounce bottles come in handy at the beginning when babies don't drink much more than that. The 8-ounce bottles should carry you through to weaning once your baby reaches a year old. Bottles may be glass, plastic, or plastic with a soft plastic liner. Some bottles have a curved design to try to reduce the amount of air a baby swallows. Nipples. Many types of nipples are on the market, which have openings sized according to a baby's age: newborn, 3-month-old, 6-month-old, and so on. The flow rate from the nipple is appropriate to the baby's age. It's important that formula flows from the nipple at the correct speed. Milk flow that's either too fast or too slow can cause your baby to swallow too much air, leading to stomach discomfort and the need for frequent burping. Test the flow of the nipple by turning the bottle upside down and timing the drops. 1 drop a second is about right. Choosing a formula. If you're planning to feed your baby infant formula, you may have many questions. Is one brand of infant formula better than another? Are generic brands okay? Is soy-based formula better than cow's milk formula? A wide variety of infant formulas are on the market. The majority of them are based on cow's milk. However, never use regular cow's milk as a substitute for formula. In processing formula, the milk has been changed dramatically to make it safe for babies. This processing includes treating formula by heat to make the protein in it more digestible. More milk sugar, lactose, is added to make the concentration similar to that of breast milk, and the fat, butter fat, is removed and replaced with vegetable oils and animal fats that are more easily digested by infants. Infant formulas aren't just easy to digest. They must contain the right amounts of carbohydrates, fat, and protein to meet babies' needs. The Food and Drug Administration, FDA, monitors commercially prepared infant formula. Each manufacturer must test each batch of formula to ensure it has the required nutrients and is free of contaminants. Infant formula is designed to be an energy-dense food. More than half its calories are made from fat. That fat is made up of fatty acids, specifically selected because they're similar to those found in breast milk. These fatty acids help in the development of your baby's brain and nervous system, as well as in meeting his or her energy needs. Types. Commercial infant formulas are regulated by the FDA. 3 major types are available. Cow's milk formulas. Most infant formula is made with cow's milk that's been altered to resemble breast milk. This gives the formula the right balance of nutrients and makes the formula easier to digest. Most babies do well on cow's milk formula. Some babies, however, such as those allergic to the proteins in cow's milk, may need other types of infant formula. Soy-based formulas. Soy-based formulas can be useful if you want to exclude animal proteins from your child's diet. Soy-based formulas may also be an option for babies who are intolerant or allergic to cow's milk formula or to lactose, a sugar naturally found in cow's milk. However, babies who are allergic to cow's milk may also be allergic to soy milk. Protein hydrolysate formulas. These are meant for babies who have a milk or soy allergy. Protein hydrolysate formulas are easier to digest and less likely to cause allergic reactions than are other types of formula. They're also called hyperallergenic formulas. In addition, you can find specialized formulas that are made for premature infants and babies who have specific medical conditions. Forms. Infant formulas typically come in 3 forms. The best choice depends on your budget and convenience needs. Powdered formula. Powdered formula is the least expensive. It must be mixed with water. Concentrated liquid formula. This type of formula also is mixed with water. Ready-to-use formula. Ready-to-use formula is the most convenient type of infant formula. It doesn't need to be mixed with water. It's also the most expensive option. Generic versus brand name. All infant formulas sold in the United States, both generic and brand name, must meet the nutrient standards set by the FDA. Although manufacturers may vary in their formula recipes, the FDA requires that all formulas contain the minimum recommended amount and no more than the maximum amount of nutrients that infants need. Additional ingredients. It's important to buy iron-fortified infant formula. Your baby needs iron to grow and develop, especially during infancy. If you're not breastfeeding, using iron-fortified formula is the easiest way to provide this essential nutrient. Some infant formulas are enhanced with docosahexaenoic acid, DHA, and arachidonic acid, ARA. These are essential fatty acids found in breast milk and certain foods, such as fish and eggs. Some studies suggest that including DHA and ARA in infant formula can help infant eyesight and brain development, but other research has shown no benefit. In addition, in an effort to mimic the immune benefits of breast milk, some infant formulas now include probiotics, substances that promote the presence of healthy bacteria in the intestines. The data on probiotic supplemented formulas is limited, and long-term benefits or complications of the formula are unknown. At this point, there's insufficient evidence to recommend the use of enhanced formulas. In addition, they tend to be more expensive than regular formula. If you think your child might benefit from formula supplemented with probiotics or another substance, talk to your baby's medical provider for additional information and guidance. Preparation. Whatever type and form of formula you use, proper preparation and storage are essential, both to ensure the appropriate amount of nutrition and to safeguard the health of your baby. Wash hands and supplies. Wash your hands before handling formula or the equipment used to prepare it. All equipment that you use to measure, mix, and store formula should be washed with hot, soapy water, and then rinsed and dried before every use. Sterilize new bottles, nipples, caps, and rings before using them for the first time. Boil the utensils in water for 5 minutes. Use a pot that's large enough to hold the utensils and cover them completely with water. Remove the utensils from the water using a clean set of tongs. Allow the utensils to air dry. After the first use, there's no need to sterilize your utensils as long as you wash and rinse them well. Use a bottle brush to wash bottles. Brush or rub the nipples thoroughly to remove any traces of formula. Rinse well. You can also clean bottles and nipples in the dishwasher. To help prevent fungal growth, you can rinse nipples daily in equal parts vinegar and water and allow them to air dry. Also, make sure the nipples are open. Hold each nipple upside down and fill it with water. Then look for the water to drip slowly out of the nipple. Mix it up. To prepare a bottle of formula, follow carefully the instructions on the label. For ready-to-use formula, shake the container and pour the recommended amount into the bottle. When using powder formula or liquid concentrate, always add the exact amount of water specified on the label. Measurements on bottles may be inaccurate, so pre-measure the water before adding it to the formula. Using too much or too little water isn't good for your baby. If formula is too diluted, your baby won't get enough nutrition for his or her growth needs and to satisfy his or her hunger. Formula that's too concentrated puts strain on the baby's digestive system and kidneys and could dehydrate your baby. You can use any type of safe drinkable water, tap or bottled, to prepare liquid concentrate or powdered formula. If you're concerned about the safety of your tap water, bring cold tap water to a rolling boil for 1 minute only, then cool the water to room temperature for no more than 30 minutes before using it. Warm if needed. Warming formula isn't necessary for nutritional purposes, but your baby may prefer it warm. To warm formula, place a filled bottle in a bowl or pan of hot, but not boiling, water, and let it stand for a few minutes. Or warm the bottle under running water. Shake the bottle after warming it. Turn the bottle upside down, and allow a drop or two of formula to fall on your wrist or the back of your hand. The formula should feel lukewarm, not hot. Don't warm bottles in the microwave. The formula may heat unevenly, creating hot spots that could burn your baby's mouth. Store safely. Store unopened formula containers in a cool, dry place. Don't store formula containers outdoors or in a car or garage, where temperature extremes can affect the quality of the formula. If you're using ready-to-use formula, cover and refrigerate any leftover formula from a freshly opened container. If you prepare and fill several bottles of liquid concentrate or powdered formula at once, label each bottle with the date that the formula was prepared. Refrigerate the extra bottles until you need them. Don't freeze them. Put the bottles toward the back of the refrigerator where it's coldest. Discard any prepared formula that's been in the refrigerator more than 24 to 48 hours. Discard any formula that remains in the bottle after a feeding. If you're unsure whether a particular container or bottle of formula is safe, throw it out. Milk allergy. A person of any age can have a milk allergy, but it's more common among infants. A milk allergy occurs when the body's immune system mistakenly identifies the protein in milk as something the body should fight off. Some infants have a severe reaction to milk, such as hives, vomiting, or trouble breathing within minutes or up to 2 hours of eating milk products. These types of reactions can be life-threatening and should prompt immediate medical attention. More commonly, babies may have milk protein intolerance, which is different from an allergic reaction, but can still cause problems such as bloody stools, diarrhea, and possibly reflux. Avoiding milk and milk-based foods, including in your diet if you're breastfeeding, is usually enough to resolve symptoms. Fortunately, most children outgrow milk protein intolerance by age 1 and milk allergy by age 3. Cow's milk is the usual cause of milk allergy. However, milk from sheep, goats, and water buffalo also can cause a reaction. And some children who are allergic to cow's milk are allergic to soy milk too. Because most formula is derived from cow's milk, infants who are formula fed may have a higher risk of developing a milk allergy than those who are breastfed. However, the milk protein in dairy products that triggers the allergic reaction can cross into breast milk and may bother a breastfeeding baby. Researchers don't fully understand why some infants develop a milk allergy and others don't. If you use formula and your son or daughter has a milk allergy, your doctor may advise you to switch to another type of formula that's less likely to cause an allergic reaction. If you're breastfeeding, restrict the amount of dairy products you consume. Look before you buy. Don't buy or use outdated infant formula. If the expiration date is passed, you can't be sure of the formula's quality. While checking the expiration date, also inspect the condition of the formula container. Don't buy or use formula from containers with bulges, dents, leaks, or rust spots. Formula in a damaged container may be unsafe. Burping positions. Lay baby face down across your lap and gently rub and pat baby's back. While sitting baby upright and supporting his or her chin and back, gently rub and pat baby's back. Lay baby face down across your shoulder and gently rub and pat his or her back. Getting into position. The first step to bottle feeding is to get comfortable. Find a quiet place where you and your baby can relax and not be distracted. Cradle your baby in one arm, hold the bottle with the other, and settle into a comfortable chair, preferably one with broad, low armrests. You may want to put a pillow on your lap, under the baby for support. Pull your baby in toward you snugly, but not too tightly. Cradled in your arm with his or her head raised slightly and resting in the bend of your elbow. This semi-upright position makes swallowing easier. Using the nipple of the bottle or a finger of the hand holding it, gently stroke your baby's cheek near the mouth on the side nearest you. The touch will cause your baby to turn toward you, often with an open mouth. Then touch the nipple to your baby's lips or the corner of the mouth. Your baby will open his or her mouth and gradually begin sucking. When feeding your baby, position the bottle at about a 45-degree angle. This angle keeps the nipple full of milk. Hold the body steady as your baby feeds. If your baby falls asleep while bottle feeding, it may be because he or she has had enough milk, or gas has made your baby full. Take the bottle away, burp your baby, then start to feed again. Always hold your baby while feeding. Never prop a bottle up against your infant. Propping may cause your baby to vomit and may lead to overeating. In addition, never give a bottle to your baby when he or she is lying on his or her back. This may increase your baby's risk of developing an ear infection. Although your baby doesn't have teeth yet, they're forming beneath the gums. Avoid making a habit of putting your baby to bed with a bottle. Formula lingers in the mouth of a baby who falls asleep while sucking a bottle. The prolonged contact of sugar in milk with teeth can cause tooth decay. What's the right amount? During the first few weeks, your baby will likely drink about 1 to 3 ounces at each feeding. You'll know that your young one is getting enough formula if by the end of the first week, he or she has about 6 to 8 wet diapers a day. He or she may also experience 1 or 2 bowel movements a day. As he or she grows, the amount of formula your baby consumes will gradually increase. In general, during the first month, expect 6 to 12 feedings in a 24-hour period, about every 2 to 4 hours. By 6 months, your baby will probably consume 6 to 8 ounces at each of 4 or 5 feedings a day. Weaning. Infant formula is generally recommended until 1 year of age, followed by whole milk until age 2. But talk with your child's medical provider for specific guidance. Reduced fat or skim milk generally isn't appropriate before age 2 because it doesn't have enough calories or fat to promote early development. Experts recommend weaning your baby from a bottle to a cup by no later than 18 months. Spitting up. Spitting up is a rite of passage for many babies. Although it's messy, you probably don't need to worry. Spitting up rarely signifies a serious problem. As long as your baby seems comfortable and is gaining weight, there's generally little cause for concern. If you keep a burp cloth within reach at all times, you'll be well prepared. Reflux. Normally a valve between the esophagus and the stomach. Lower esophageal sphincter keeps stomach contents where they belong. Until this valve has time to mature, spitting up may be an issue, especially if your baby eats too much or too quickly. Spitting up tends to peak at age 4 months, and most babies stop spitting up by 12 months. Minimal spitting up doesn't hurt. It isn't likely to cause coughing, choking, or discomfort, even during sleep. Chances are your baby won't even notice the fluid dripping out of his or her mouth. What you can do to reduce spitting up, consider these tips. Keep your baby upright. Position baby's head higher than the rest of the body when feeding. Follow each feeding with 15 to 30 minutes in a sitting position. Hold your baby in your arms, or try a front pack, backpack, or infant seat. Avoid active play and infant swings while the food is settling. Try smaller, more frequent feedings. Feeding your baby too much at once can contribute to spitting up. If you're breastfeeding, limit the length of each nursing session. If you're bottle feeding, offer your baby slightly less than usual. Take time to burp your baby. Frequent burps during and after each feeding can keep air from building up in your baby's stomach. Sit your baby upright, supporting your baby's head with one hand while patting his or her back with your other hand. Babies don't burp after every feeding, though, so you don't need to prolong the burping process. Check the nipple. If you're using a bottle, make sure the hole in the nipple is the right size. If it's too large, the milk will flow too fast. If it's too small, your baby might get frustrated and gulp air. Experiment with your diet. If you're breastfeeding, your baby's doctor might suggest that you eliminate dairy products or certain other foods from your diet. Pay attention to baby's sleep position. To reduce the risk of sudden infant death syndrome, SIDS, it's important to place your baby to sleep on his or her back. Placing a baby to sleep on his or her tummy is rarely recommended to prevent spitting up. When it's more serious, more severe spitting up may indicate something more serious. Contact your baby's medical provider if your baby isn't gaining weight. Spits up so forcefully that stomach contents shoot out of his or her mouth, vomits. Spits up gray or yellow fluid, blood, or a material that looks like coffee grounds. Resists feedings. Has blood in his or her stool. Has other signs of illness, such as fever, diarrhea, or difficulty breathing. Some babies experience infant gastroesophageal reflux. Special feeding techniques or medication may be helpful. Chapter 4, To Solid Foods and Beyond. When your child is first born, breast milk or formula is the only food he or she needs. Eventually, though, your baby will begin to develop the coordination to move solid food from the front of his or her mouth to the back for swallowing. At the same time, your baby's head control will improve, and he or she will learn to sit with limited support. These are essential skills for eating solid foods. As you expand your child's diet to meet his or her nutritional needs, you'll also have an early opportunity to encourage healthy eating habits. By setting up a regular schedule for meals and snacks, you'll create a predictable and comfortable routine that your child can rely on. By making family meals a priority, even when your child is young, you'll encourage sociability and togetherness. You can promote this further by keeping mealtimes relaxed and keeping cell phones, televisions, and other devices turned off during meals. These early habits will help your child develop a lifetime appreciation for nourishing his or her body with a variety of healthy foods in the context of a safe and comforting setting. That's what healthy eating is all about, and it's never too early to start. Starting solids. So when are babies ready for solid foods? It varies a bit based on a child's development. Signs that your baby might be ready include being able to sit in a high chair or booster chair, hold his or her head upright, show an interest in food, and open his or her mouth for a spoon. The American Academy of Pediatrics, AAP, recommends waiting until a child is at least 4 months old before introducing solid foods to complement breast milk or formula, and preferably holding off until a child is closer to 6 months old. If you have questions about starting solid foods, check with your child's medical provider. First foods. Single grain baby cereal has traditionally been used and is fortified to meet infants' nutritional needs after 6 months of age. But there's no one right first food. Pureed meats also are a good choice, as they are rich in iron and zinc, essential nutrients that are present at birth, but those levels decrease steadily over the first few months. You can also add in pureed vegetables and fruits. Pureed beans and leafy dark green vegetables contain iron, and the vitamin C in many fruits and vegetables helps iron absorption. Formula or breast milk can be mixed in to thin the puree if needed. Studies show that children who are introduced to vegetables and flavorful foods early on are more likely to eat those foods later in childhood. Avoid seasoning your infant's food with added salt or sugar. Getting started. Use a small spoon, one that will fit into your baby's mouth, and begin with very small amounts. At first, your little one may frown, sputter, and spit it out. This isn't necessarily because he or she doesn't like it, but rather because he or she may not be familiar with moving the tongue backward yet. Wait for your baby to open his or her mouth for the spoon. Don't force food in. If he or she repeatedly uses his or her tongue to push the spoon away, this may be an indication that your baby isn't ready for solids yet. Don't be surprised if your baby puts fingers to mouth to help swallow the food. He or she may also try to bat away the spoon. Expect it to be a messy experience. To prevent baby from getting frustrated when he or she is very hungry, try alternating between breast milk or formula and spoonfuls of food. Some parents skip pureed food entirely and let baby lead the learning process by self-feeding appropriate finger foods offered by the parent. Once your little one gets used to solids, he or she may be ready for a few tablespoons of food a day, including finger foods. By the end of the first year, most children obtain about half of their nutrition from breast milk or formula, and half from complementary foods. Taste and texture. Babies also react to how food feels and tastes in their mouths. While you don't have to follow a particular sequence of food groups, it may help to introduce different tastes and textures gradually. Offer single-ingredient foods at first, and wait 3 to 5 days between each new food. If your baby has a reaction to a particular food, such as diarrhea, a rash, or vomiting, you'll know the culprit. Spacing out new foods also gives your child a chance to get used to a new taste and texture. It often takes quite a few tries, up to 15 or more, for a new food to gain acceptance. Pureed foods. Foods that are soft and runny may be easier for your baby to manage at first. One option is to mix 1 tablespoon of a single-grain, iron-fortified baby cereal with 4 to 5 tablespoons of breast milk or formula. Or add breast milk or formula to pureed meat, vegetables, or fruit to attain a similar consistency. Though it will be quite runny, resist the urge to serve it from a bottle. As your baby learns to manage this consistency, serve foods with a thicker pureed consistency. Keep in mind that some babies eat such foods with gusto right from the start. Others are less enthusiastic. Be patient and keep trying. Finger foods. By about 9 months, most babies can handle small portions of finger foods, such as well-steamed vegetables, soft fruits, well-cooked pasta, cheese, graham crackers, and tender meats. As your baby approaches his or her first birthday, mashed or chopped versions of whatever the rest of the family is eating will likely become your baby's main fare. Continue to offer your child breast milk or formula with and between meals. Juice. Juice, while a popular beverage, is not a necessary part of a baby's diet. Whole fruits have more nutritional value than juice. If you choose to give your child juice, be sure to use 100% fruit juice after 12 months of age and limit the amount to no more than 4 ounces a day. Too much juice may contribute to weight problems, tooth decay, and digestive issues such as diarrhea. You also don't want juice to take the place of more nutritious solid foods, breast milk, or formula. What's off limits? Don't offer cow's milk, citrus, honey, or corn syrup to your child before he or she is 12 months old. Cow's milk doesn't meet an infant's nutritional needs. It isn't a good source of iron, and too much can lead to iron deficiency anemia. Citrus can cause a painful diaper rash, and honey and corn syrup may contain spores that can cause a serious illness known as infant botulism. In addition, don't offer your child foods that could pose a choking hazard. Such foods include small, slippery foods, such as whole grapes, hot dogs, or hard candy. Dry foods that are hard to chew, such as popcorn, raw carrots, and nuts. sticky or tough foods, such as plain peanut butter or chunks of steak. If you haven't done so yet, consider taking an infant cardiopulmonary resuscitation CPR course. This is strongly recommended for all parents and very helpful in case of a choking episode. Baby-led feeding. A growing trend in Europe, Australia, and the US is allowing children who are 6 months or older to feed themselves solid foods, baby-led weaning or feeding, to encourage exploration of food and to let them regulate how much food they eat. The key part is letting babies guide the food into their own mouths. Preliminary studies conclude that this method may decrease food fussiness. There was no difference in weight between self-fed babies and spoon-fed babies. The main concern with babies feeding themselves is the risk of choking, but evidence suggests that self-feeding is as safe as being spoon-fed, as long as appropriate precautions are taken. To prevent choking while eating, make sure your child is seated in an upright position and is always supervised. Don't leave your baby unattended. Offer foods that are easy to pick up and are either mashable in your baby's mouth or easy to gnaw on without breaking up into small pieces that block your child's airway. Think steamed carrots, roasted sweet potato, or cooked chicken, cut into pieces about the length of an adult's pinky finger. Avoid foods that are small, coin-shaped, slippery, crunchy, sticky, or tough. Foods for baby. By your baby's first birthday, he or she should be able to eat most of the food served to the rest of the family. Just make sure food isn't too hot or a choking hazard, and avoid giving foods that are heavily spiced, salted, or sweetened. If you want to prep food for your baby, use a blender or a food processor to puree the food or cut the food into small bite-sized pieces. For smaller foods, you may be able to simply mash them with a fork. Here are some examples of foods to try. Apples, peeled and cut in eighths. Orange sections, peeled and loose membrane removed. Peaches, ripe and peeled. Small pieces of banana. Egg, boiled, scrambled, or poached. Soft cheese. Soft custards or puddings. Yogurt. Cooked soft carrots and other vegetables. Well-cooked macaroni, pasta, egg noodles, and rice. Pieces of toast or bagels. Tender meats, fish, tuna, lamb, chicken, turkey, and some beef and pork. Spaghetti with meat sauce. Pancakes and waffles. Whole grain crackers and cereals. Introducing peanut butter, milk, and other foods. Some foods can cause problems if they're not introduced at appropriate times. Peanuts and other allergenic foods. To help prevent food allergies, parents were once told to delay feeding infants eggs, fish, and peanut butter. But today, researchers say postponing the introduction of highly allergenic foods beyond 4 to 6 months of age hasn't been shown to prevent eczema, asthma, allergic rhinitis, or food allergy. In fact, recent evidence suggests that introduction of peanut butter or peanut-containing foods as early as 4 months may help prevent the development of peanut allergy. This is especially true for babies at increased risk of peanut allergies, such as those with eczema, an egg allergy, or a family history of food allergies. If your baby started eating solid foods already and hasn't shown signs of any food allergies, you can introduce a bit of peanut butter, thinned with breast milk, formula, or pureed food. Avoid giving thick peanut butter from the jar or whole nuts. If your baby tolerates it, you can gradually increase the amount given. When introducing other allergenic foods, stick to textures your baby eats and likes. If your baby has eczema or food allergies run in your family, talk to your baby's medical provider before introducing peanut butter. The provider may recommend having your baby tested for peanut allergy first. The importance of iron. Iron is a nutrient that's essential to your child's growth and development. Iron helps move oxygen from the lungs to the rest of the body and helps muscles store and use oxygen. Babies are born with iron stored in their bodies, but a steady amount of additional iron is needed to fuel a child's rapid growth and development. Infant formulas are fortified with iron, but if you breastfeed your baby, start him or her on an iron supplement at 4 months of age. If your baby was born early, your provider likely recommended beginning an iron supplement earlier. As your baby grows and begins to eat other foods, serve iron-rich foods. When you begin serving your baby solids, typically between ages 4 months and 6 months, feed him or her foods with added iron, such as iron-fortified baby cereal and pureed meats. For older children, good sources of iron include red meat, chicken, fish, and tofu. Don't overdo milk. Once your little one turns a year old and starts drinking milk, don't allow him or her to drink more than 24 ounces of milk a day. Too much milk can inhibit the body's absorption of iron. Enhance iron absorption. On the other hand, vitamin C helps promote the absorption of dietary iron. You can help your child absorb iron by offering foods rich in vitamin C, such as cantaloupe, strawberries, bell peppers, tomatoes, and dark green vegetables. Cow's milk. Around your baby's first birthday, you may gradually introduce your child to whole cow's milk. Of course, continue to breastfeed your baby as long as you wish. Cow's milk isn't a replacement for breast milk or formula. But as your baby gains nutrients from a wider variety of foods, dairy milk can be an important source of vitamin D, calcium, fat, and protein. The AAP recommends that children be given whole milk until age 2. Low-fat milk, such as 2%, 1%, and skim, doesn't provide enough fat for your child's developing brain and shouldn't be given until your child is 2 years old, unless specifically recommended by your child's medical provider. Alternative milks, such as soy, nut, and plant-based milks, are typically fortified with vitamin D and calcium, but most contain lower fat content than whole cow's milk. Talk with your child's medical provider before introducing milk if you have questions and especially if your child was diagnosed with a milk protein intolerance or allergy. Limit your child's milk intake to no more than 16 to 24 ounces a day. Higher intake may crowd out other necessary foods and is associated with iron deficiency anemia. Family mealtimes. Mealtimes are an important part of family life. They offer family members a chance to come together to share not just food, but companionship. Whenever possible, have your baby eat at the same time as the rest of the family. This helps your baby get used to the process of eating, sitting down, choosing foods to eat, resting between bites, and stopping when full, and socializing with others. These early experiences will help your child learn good eating habits that last a lifetime. Research shows that families that eat together regularly tend to eat more nutritious foods and are less likely to encounter childhood obesity or eating disorders. Children are also more likely to have better behavior, a stronger vocabulary, and greater academic success. Tips for babies. To help mealtimes be a pleasant experience for everyone, consider these suggestions. Stay seated. At first, you may feed your baby propped on your lap. As soon as your baby can sit easily without support, use a high chair with a broad, stable base. Buckle the safety straps and keep other children from climbing or hanging onto the high chair. Encourage exploration. Your baby is likely to play with his or her food between bites. Although it's messy, this hands-on approach helps fuel your baby's brain development. Placing a drop cloth on the floor can help. Offer your baby new foods to try. To increase the chances of acceptance, offer one new food along with an established favorite. Most babies can and should eat from all food groups as soon as 7 to 8 months of age. Introduce utensils. Offer your baby a spoon to hold while you feed him or her with another spoon. As your baby's dexterity improves, encourage your baby to dip the spoon in food and bring it to his or her mouth. After your baby turns a year old, his or her use of utensils will continue to develop. Give your child the chance to practice. Offer a cup. Feeding your baby breast milk or formula from a cup at mealtime can pave the way for weaning from a bottle. When your child reaches 9 months, he or she may be able to drink from a cup on his or her own, but spills are likely until about 15 months or so. You may want to begin with a non-spill cup, often called a sippy cup. Dish individual servings. Early on, your baby may eat just a few spoonfuls of food at a time. If you feed your baby directly from a jar or container, bacteria and saliva from the spoon can quickly spoil any leftovers. Instead, place 1 tablespoon of food in a dish and refrigerate the rest. The same goes for finger foods. If your baby finishes the first serving, offer another. Know when to call it quits. When your baby has had enough, he or she may turn away from the food, lean backward, or refuse to open his or her mouth. Don't force extra bites. As long as your baby's growth is on target, you can be confident that he or she is getting enough to eat. When babies are allowed to decide how much food they want to eat and how fast to eat it, they become fairly adept at it, and doing so allows them to regulate their food intake based on how hungry they are, which contributes to a healthy weight now and later. Tips for toddlers. As your child moves into toddlerhood, you may notice a drop in his or her appetite. Your child may become fussy about what he or she eats, run away after a few bites, or resist coming to the table at mealtimes. This is normal and frustrating. After the first year of life, your child's growth rate slows and he or she doesn't require as many calories. To keep encouraging healthy eating habits in your growing child, follow these steps. Minimize distractions. Make the most of family mealtimes. Turn off TVs, phones, and other electronic devices. This helps your toddler and everyone else focus on the meal and each other. Even if your child isn't using words yet, he or she enjoys the back and forth communication going on and the feeling of being part of the family. This sort of stimulation is important to your child's mental, social, and emotional development. Keep portions small. As your child gets older, avoid giving too much at once, which can seem overwhelming. Put a small amount, about the size of your child's fist, of each food group on the plate. Then offer seconds if your child wants more. Don't sweat the picky eater. Picky eating habits are common in the toddler years and through preschool, but these behaviors generally ease with age. You're not responsible for making your child like certain foods, but you can present multiple opportunities for your son or daughter to learn about food and to try different kinds. Include your child in shopping for food, feeling the shape and texture of different food items, watching food being prepared, and maybe even...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.